Get started in just a moment. We're waiting for a few more people to trickle in. We'll get started in just a moment or two. Good afternoon. We're just going to give it one more moment and then we'll go ahead and get started. Thank you for participating. It'll be just another moment. All right, hello and good afternoon. My name is Eric Titano. Hopefully you can hear me. Hope you're all having a great day. I am a manager for the outage communications team for Southern California Edison in our customer engagement division. On behalf of my team and the customer engagement division, I want to thank you all for taking time out of your day to join us for one of our 2023 Power Talks. We're hoping this information is valuable to you. And at the very end, we're hoping maybe you can give us some feedback and let us know how we did or what areas we can improve on. A few housekeeping items before we go and get started. If we touch a topic or if you have a question about a particular topic, just go ahead and drop it in the chat, type out a question to us. We do have a couple monitors that are watching. And they'll either stop us as we go, or we'll definitely try to field them all at the very end. If you see some links or if you see some websites on the presentation, you don't have to write them down really quick. We will send you a thank you post email that has all the links, all the resources that we refer to included on there. There'll also be a survey on the post email that we send out. If you're interested in getting a hard copy, or I guess an email copy of this presentation, if you fill out the survey, it's only 6 or 7 questions, takes only a couple minutes. If you want a copy of the presentation, just fill out this short survey and we'll send you a link, or we'll send you a PDF version of our presentation. And before we go and get started with the actual presentation, safety is one of our key components, one of our key values with Edison. It's an inherently dangerous industry. And we usually start off all of our meetings with some sort of safety moment. For this meeting, I'd like to talk a little bit about Mylar metallic balloons and just raise awareness to the hazard that they could present. These metallic balloons, they should never be released outdoors. They have a habit of getting into our power lines and for one causing an outage, which can be disruptive, but they also run the risk of causing wires to come down, which becomes definitely a public safety hazard. As you can see on the chart there, we tend to see an escalation in the number of outages caused by metallic balloons starting in February. Typically around Valentine's Day. And then it just progresses through the springtime. We have Mother's Day, Memorial Day, and then graduation season where it really hits a spike. And this is a curve that we see traditionally every year. And we just want to raise awareness because if the lines do come down, it could present a hazard to a pedestrian that's on the ground. And having the power off is bad enough, but we definitely don't want to have anyone harmed. I believe I missed the agenda. So the topics that we'll be going over today, we'll have a couple of members from my team. Taylor Ruiz will be presenting and talking about different types of outages that you might encounter as a customer with Edison. Luis Lara will be talking about wildfire mitigation strategy that we're deploying with Edison and what that means for us, you know, coming up into the fall when we have that windy season coming up. I'll probably take it back for the preparedness discussion and talk about communication resources that are available, and then we'll have a final chance for any final questions and answers. But throughout the presentation, if you do, like I said, if you do have a question, feel free to put it in the chat and we'll try to address it as we go. And with that, I'm going to go and hand it over to Taylor Ruiz, who will begin a discussion on the outages.
Good afternoon, everyone. Yes, now we will discuss the types of outages that our customers could experience. Majority of our outages are maintenance outages. However, there are also four other types of outages. First, our maintenance outages are scheduled work. The repair outages are unplanned and caused unexpectedly, usually by a car hit, pull, or Mylar balloons in our lines. So there's no advance notice. Same with the emergency outages. These are emergent repairs that are needed in order to avoid a prolonged repair outage. Our public safety power shutoffs are preventative outages caused by extreme weather conditions, and we will cover the notification process more in depth in a later presentation. We also have our public agency outages. These are initiated by our firefighters or our first responders when SC's facilities could pose a danger to their work. We will go into more depth on these over the next few slides. Over the past several years, we've been averaging well over 32,000 maintenance outages each year as we work to harden our grid in high fire risk areas and ensure that we're able to usher in a modern, technologically advanced grid of tomorrow. This year, we are scheduled more work, especially on the grid hardening and wildfire mitigation front, which my partner today, Luis, will cover more in depth later on the presentation. One of the most common components of our outage process is the notification piece. Once an outage is entered into our system, the notification process will begin. The automated messages for these outages are sent 10 to 11 days in advance to customers enrolled for outage alerts via text, phone, email, informing customers of the maintenance outages. 8 to 10 days before the outage, physical outage letters are printed and sent via U.S. mail to all customers. We also send an automated reminder notice the day before the outage is to take place. On the day of the outage, we will keep you informed of the progress and any updates that may take place during the outage, such as updates on the restoration and when service is restored to your location. As such, we encourage our customers to kindly keep their contact information updated at all times. This will ensure that you receive not only the outage notification, but also any updates that may occur. There are many reasons why a maintenance outage may be canceled. Weather, unsafe equipment discovered at the last minute, permitting from the city or the county, the job site might not be ready for multiple reasons, abnormal conditions with the circuit condition changing from the time of the program was written to the time that we're about to do the work. Also, resources getting pulled for emergency work. There are many causes for unplanned repair outages. Now, I won't bore you by going through each one, but I will highlight a few of the most common impacts. Birds and animals can get into our equipment often. It's common for a bird or squirrel to contact our equipment and cause a large power outage. In those areas where this occurs frequently, SC will work to install bird guards and squirrel guards in order to dissuade animals from getting into our equipment. Another common repair outage is a car hitting a pole. As you can see on the picture, this is a car hit pole. Car hitting pole. This is a common cause for our power interruptions, typically on a Friday or Saturday night, Super Bowl Sundays. Please keep in mind that most customers are restored within the first 90 minutes of a repair outage. Many of the circuits in our territory have automation where if a fault occurs and the power goes out, the circuit will test itself and try to re-energize after 30 seconds. If the fault condition is no longer present, the power will stay on. However, if the condition still exists, for example, a tree slash animal is still contacting the lines, the power will test bad and the power will go back off. In this case, Edison will send out field personnel to patrol and troubleshoot the circuit to locate and isolate the problem and restore power to as many customers as possible while we finish our work. Sign up and receive automated notifications, text, email, or phone, whatever your preferred method is. As stated during our safety moment, Mylar balloons are also a very common cause of outages. On the next slide, we have a short video of what can happen to our equipment when a balloon makes contact. As you can see, Mylar balloons, although fun and nice to look at, can cause major damage to our equipment. So be sure to keep them secured. And when you are done enjoying them, cut the knot and or puncture the balloon before disposing of them. Also, again, never try to retrieve balloons in power lines or electrical equipment. Call 911 instead. The last type of outage that I will cover are rotating outages. Rotating outages occur when demand for power is greater than the available supply. The California Independent System Operator, also known as CAISO, is the agency that monitors the supply and demand throughout the state, and they may direct the utilities to implement various tools and programs to reduce the demand. If you go to the rotating outage section of Southern California Edison's website, you can see the following information: status of the current event, the next group scheduled to be impacted, maps of the rotating outage groups. The last rotating outage event our service territory experienced was August of 2020. However, prior to that, it last occurred in 2001, so it doesn't occur often. These typical events only last 1 hour. We manage and rotate groups of customers throughout the service territory to protect the integrity of the grid, so it is not one area getting hit all at once. Once your group ID is called, then it will be moved from the front of the line to the back of the line. These group IDs average approximately 30,000 customers per block. Communications are sent to all essential and critical customer cares via phone, text, and email. This is why it's so important to ensure you are enrolled in our automated notifications. ISO provides full visibility to the Western grid load curves, enabling customers to see the limitation of the grid and the points at which load peaks call for progressive action. As you can see, we start the process and roll early by communicating various conservation messages, such as Flex Alert. By the time we reach Energy Emergency Alert Level 2, we trigger our demand response programs like our AC cycling program. Once we hit EEA3, we deploy load interruption and mandatory load drop protocols such as our base interruptible program. As a last resort, we initiate rotating outages. The summer discount program is an example of a residential program where Edison can reduce electrical demand by shutting off the air conditioning unit to customers enrolled in the program. We also have similar available for our commercial customers. The customers can easily find their rotating outage segment number on their bill and in the advanced notifications we provide to them. They can access that on SCE.com's site for more information of these rotating outage functions and what we can expect for their neighborhoods. Once a segment has been cycled off, their number moves to the back of the line. Luis will be taking over from here.
All right, so thank you for that, Taylor. And again, just wanted to welcome everyone to today's conversation. I know there's going to be quite a bit of a wealth of information that we're feeding, but Any questions, please feel free to drop them in the chat. And again, just to direct your attention to the chat, our colleague will be dropping some links in there for you. So as we continue to deliver or provide more information, you can find more and more details on the specific topics that we're covering. So let me go ahead and jump in into the public safety power shutoff portion. So today I'm just going to give you a high level overview of the deployment of technologies that we have in the field in our high fire risk areas, the impacts of those technologies in the field to our communities, and what we're doing moving forward. We have had quite a few lessons learned from this and in this space. So let's just go ahead and jump in. So, yes, this is a very, very busy slide, but I do want to highlight a few key aspects of it for you. Now, let's start with the lay of the land. So Edison services a territory of approximately 50,000 square miles, of which about 27% lies within a high fire risk area. Our multi-year, multi-pronged wildfire mitigation approach is really focused on in that one quarter of our service territory, which incidentally also encompasses approximately one quarter of our customer base. Now, I am happy to report that by the end of 2022, SCE successfully met and exceeded our goals around high fire risk area asset inspections by approximately 8%, exceeded the installed covered conductor goal by approximately 27%, and installed an additional 160 weather stations and 16 high definition cameras in those high fire risk areas. We also continued our support of a quick reactionary force for aerial fire suppression. This support translates to approximately $18 million for multiple helitankers that do have the capability to perform nighttime operations during live wildfire events. Okay, so I know I said a lot of stuff, and it may not mean a lot to many of you unless you've been exposed to some of these terms. So let's go ahead and dive a little bit more into these terms. So given the heightened safety sensitivity in high fire risk areas, it's important that SCE remain vigilant of asset conditions in these regions. Inspection crews may leverage drones to quickly access conditions or assess conditions of equipment and report back any need to render any repairs or replacement of equipment that has been significantly weathered by conditions. I also mentioned that we exceeded our installed covered conductor goal, but what is covered conductor? Well, one aspect of high fire risk areas is that these zones regularly experience strong wind conditions. When those strong winds do manifest, just like every year, the winds could cause the bare wire to slap together, which in turn could cause a spark. And in turn, if there's dry vegetation nearby, well, then now we have the recipe for a potential disaster. So replacing that bare wire with a covered conductor, in other words, it's that bared wire with a thick plastic sleeve covering, it will significantly reduce the likelihood of a potential ignition in the field when those winds do come through. Now, I also mentioned that we exceeded the installation goals of weather stations and high definition cameras. Now, these two goals support the commitment to bolster our situational awareness capabilities. The weather stations allow our in-house meteorologists to have a more granular view of fuel conditions to really render more informed recommendations to our team. The high definition cameras allow us the capability to have eyes, if you will, in the field in those very remote locations. We are able to pan, tilt, zoom, and really focus in those critical areas, and more importantly, share that data with emergency response agencies. Now, these numbers do reflect a lot of great work in coordination with cities, counties, critical infrastructure customers, and even our tribal nations. However, these figures are moot factors if we're not able to directly influence the well-being of our critical care customers. These are those customers with a heightened medical need for power. To that end, by the end of 2022, SCE was able to support the delivery of approximately 3,400 battery backup systems to critical care customers. Since July 2020, we've been able to distribute well over 10,000 backup battery systems to support this medical customer base. Moreover, we've been able to work with local governments to identify 64 community resource center sites that can be leveraged during PSPS events. These sites will serve as a safe place for customers that are in need of information around the ongoing PSPS event. We're able to provide snacks, restrooms, and power at these sites. We do also have the capability to deploy 8 community crew vehicles to those high fire at risk areas that can provide light snacks, water, power, and ongoing PSPS information. So what do all of these figures mean? With the thousands of assets throughout our service territory serving millions of customers, and more importantly, with approximately one quarter of those assets serving customers in high fire risk areas, it is imperative that we not only develop a comprehensive wildfire mitigation plan, but that we execute on it as quickly as safety would allow. Now, we did submit our 2023 to 2025 wildfire mitigation plan to the Public Utilities Commission in March. We are intensely aware of the impact that wildfire mitigation work and PSPS events have on our communities. So the primary objective of our plan is to preserve public safety. Our wildfire mitigation plan is actionable, measurable, and an adaptive plan intent on reducing the risk of wildfire ignitions associated with our electrical assets. Our plan remains focused on three key areas: grid hardening, enhancing our operational practices, and bolstering situational awareness capabilities. Grid hardening includes the installation of covered conductor, undergrounding assets where safe and appropriate, and of course, upgrading equipment where needed. Enhancing our operational practices means that we'll continue to focus efforts on asset inspections, vegetation management, and when deemed necessary to preserve the safety of communities, leveraging the PSPS protocol. Bolstering situational awareness capabilities reflects our commitment to remaining as informed as possible on the conditions in our service territory. This includes the installation of weather stations, high-definition cameras, as well as performing biweekly fuel sampling and utilizing enhanced weather modeling systems. And I'm sure by now you're wondering, okay, Luis, you're saying a lot of words, a lot of stuff, but how does this even work? So let's go ahead and jump into that. So the first layer of protection is the ability to remain aware of the conditions in our service territory. This includes the need to regularly assess wind conditions, fuel moisture content, fuel density, humidity, temperatures, and the influence of recent weather impacts. For example, the recent rainstorms not only increase the moisture content, but will also encourage more vegetation growth this year. The next layer is intended to address vegetation management through regular inspections and cut back vegetation where necessary. Growing that defensible space between electrical assets and vegetation from 4 feet to 12 feet now will help reduce the likelihood of a power interruption caused by palm fronds, tree branches, or any other vegetation. The next two layers focus on the regular inspection of management of electrical assets, as well as system hardening. For example, ensuring that high fire risk area assets are in optimal operational conditions, particularly after recent storm events. Again, this strategy is focused on doing our best to safeguard customers' homes and businesses. However, there is one final aspect of this strategy that we need to discuss, and that's the resiliency strategy of the end customer, of you. So if you were to lose power at your residence or your business for whatever reason, what would that mean for you and your family? What would that mean for your business operations? Is there someone at home that has a heightened medical need for power? And if so, have you developed a backup or resiliency plan to support that person? Now, we all live in earthquake country, and we've heard this commercial for a long time, right? Let's be prepared for an earthquake. So tying it back to today's conversation, how many of our families are actually truly prepared for an unplanned outage event? What if there's a fire nearby and electricity has been shut off and you need to evacuate? Do you know how to manually operate or engage your garage door? What about the elderly neighbor down the street or family member that may not be able to open the garage door manually? So this important piece of the puzzle is not intended to scare anyone, but rather to raise awareness on the need to develop an emergency backup plan that works for you, that works for your family, your business, and your community. Now, you can begin building an emergency backup plan by visiting us on sce.com, leveraging other resources like your local city's websites or even the Red Cross website, and of course, any of the state or federal emergency agencies. Now, perhaps one facet of your emergency backup plan may include obtaining information from SCE. So let's explore that in the next slide. So you can enhance your own situational awareness capabilities by ensuring that you're receiving notifications from SCE. SCE will push out notifications and updates to customers during PSPS events at regular intervals. We encourage you to ensure that we have your updated contact information at all times, and you can do this by visiting us on sce.com or through my account on sce.com. You may elect to receive outage notifications via any digital channel of your choice. That could be email, voice message, or text, or all three. So we would also encourage you to become very familiar with the outage map on sce.com, which now incorporates PSPS events. It's a very dynamic map where you can enter or type in the address of your home or business to really better gauge what potential outage events may impact your family or your business. This is a mobile-friendly device, so accessing it through your mobile device should be really easy. Now, before we jump into looking at what PSPS communications look like, I wanted to share a personal moment from my family. So we actually live in a high fire risk area, and we often have fires near our home. Now, you really wouldn't believe how quickly you lose, you know, juice on your mobile system when you know, family members see that there's a fire nearby and they're calling you every 30 seconds and they want to update what's going on. Do you guys need to leave? Do you need to evacuate, et cetera, et cetera. So with all these family members and friends that are concerned for us, we start to see the drain or the impact on our mobile devices. So one thing that we've done is we've bought some of these mobile or really portable battery banks. Now, I really can't recommend a specific brand or size of a power bank, but it's something that we do for us that works for us. And so whenever I do have the opportunity to share some of this with our customers, I want to throw that out for you. Is this something that would be a consideration for your family? Now, let me take a quick pause there and let's just go ahead and jump into the PSPS communications on the next slide. Now, SCE will remain committed to providing timely notifications to potentially impacted customers, local governments, public safety agencies, and of course, the California State Warning Center before, during, and after a de-energizing event. Now, I understand that this slide is also very busy, but I do want to highlight a few key aspects of the PSPS notifications for you. First, SCE meteorologists monitor weather impacts throughout our entire service territory. It's 24/7. Their primary role is to sound the alarm if weather modeling reflects a potential threat in a region. That threat can range from extreme or prolonged heat, snow, rain, or even wind events, or perhaps avalanche threats in some of those more remote locations. So once our meteorologists identify the potential threat, they'll begin to sound the alarm internally, and an incident management team, or what we call an IMT, will be assembled. If the team determines that weather modeling reflects a real-world threat, then the IMT will begin to engage with local city, county, and tribal governments, as well as critical infrastructure customers. Now, critical infrastructure customers are water, wastewater customers, hospitals, emergency personnel, telecom, et cetera, et cetera. So if weather modeling and fuel conditions continue trending equally, then we'll begin to push out notifications to all customers that may be impacted in that specific region. This notification is pushed out approximately 2 days in advance of what we call the period of concern. So the period of concern is that time period where weather modeling reflects as the most likely period when we are most likely to leverage the PSPS protocol. In other words, proactively shut off power to customers. So it's at this initial notification that we would highly encourage all customers to begin considering leveraging their own emergency battery backup plan, excuse me. SCE will continue to push out daily notifications to customers, advising them that we're actively monitoring conditions in their area and that they should consider leveraging their emergency backup plan continuously. If we have the luxury of time, then we'll push out what's called an imminent shutdown notification. This means that we are likely to shut off your power within the next 1 to 4 hours. Now, I did qualify it as if we have the luxury of time, because one thing that we have learned is that weather is extremely volatile. So the weather report in the morning could let us know, hey, the threat is coming in tomorrow. However, the afternoon weather report says, hey, no need to wait for tomorrow. We need to begin de-energizing customers now because the threat is upon us now. Now, the other notification I want to highlight for you is the preparing to re-energize notification. Now, this is one notification I do highlight every time I engage with customers, because it can really be forgotten, particularly in the chaos of an emergency event. So the purpose of this notification is to advise customers that SCE is beginning the process to restore power after a PSPS de-energizing event. Now, we cannot simply just flip the switch without first patrolling the circuit or section of circuit to ensure that it's safe to restore power. In fact, it wasn't uncommon for fuel crews to find vegetation or even debris caught on electrical equipment in the past. So let's say that our crews are patrolling, they find that a tree has actually toppled on or full on just took down a couple of lines in the field. And had those sections of circuit been energized, then there would have been a real possibility of an elevated threat introduced to that community. So before we can restore power, we need to ensure that it's safe to restore power. That is, that the poles, lines, and other equipment are clear of debris and are operating at optimal conditions. Now, please note that restoration efforts can be delayed by weather conditions, access to remote locations, or the need to patrol a circuit via helicopter. Sometimes the conditions are ready for restoration, but the winds have not died down enough to complete a helicopter patrol. In short, the estimated restoration time will be heavily dependent on the conditions at that time. Finally, please note that you may lose power for any multiple reasons during a PSPS event. It could very well be that while we're monitoring for a potential PSPS event, that a gust of wind comes up and it causes a heavy branch to fall onto power lines. In those instances, SCE will trigger a troubleman to investigate the cause of the unplanned repair outage. The troubleman will work with either to correct the issue or, if it's really large, to have a larger crew come out to render the final repairs. As with any unplanned or what we call a repair outage, we'll work to reroute power whenever possible to reduce the outage impact to the smallest footprint possible. In these instances, the fuel crew will be able to provide a more narrow estimated restoration time. Now, to ensure that you do remain informed on what's happening around you, again, I want to throw this commercial out multiple times. Let's ensure that we have your updated contact information, and you can do that by visiting us on SCE.com. Let's go ahead and jump over to the next slide. Now, the evolution of our wildfire mitigation strategy has been able to yield massive wins now, not just for SCE, but for Southern California as a whole. Since 2018, SCE has reduced the probability of catastrophic wildfires associated with our electrical assets by approximately 75 to 80%. Now, we've accomplished this through the deployment of multiple technologies and really rethinking how we approach our day-to-day operations. Since 2018, we've installed approximately 4,400 miles of conductor in high fire risk areas. So that's covered conductor. We've trimmed or removed over 1.9 million trees, performed 1 million inspections of high fire risk area assets, installed over 1,600 weather stations and over 180 high definition cameras. However, there is one stat I do want to highlight for you today. We've been able to successfully reduce the PSPS customer minutes of interruption by approximately 99% on those frequently impacted circuits in 2022 over the 2019 season. Again, this is a big win, not just for SCE, but for all of us as a community. So where do we go from here? Well, let's look into the next slide for that. Every iteration of our wildfire mitigation plan is focused on one underlying theme, and that's preserving public safety. The 2023 to 2025 wildfire mitigation strategy will focus on advanced transmission hardening, continue hardening PSPS impacts to all customers, continue reducing PSPS impacts to all of our customers, expanding aerial fire suppression funding to year-round in 2023, and continue exploring the advancement of new technologies in this space. We are looking to grow the installed weather stations from 1,600 to approximately 1,800 by 2025. We also plan on installing an additional 20 high-definition cameras through 2024 to increase the current 90% visual coverage. Now, we've also completed approximately 19 miles of undergrounding and targeted high-fire risk areas in 2022, and we'll be ramping up this scope in the next coming years. Currently, there are approximately 7,200 miles, or about 42% of primary distribution lines already undergrounded in high-fire risk areas. Now, we have been able to see significant improvements in the space over the years, and the grid has become more resilient. However, we're not at a place where we can completely rule out the leveraging of PSPS. PSPS will remain a tool of last resort when the conditions warrant the need. We will continue to deploy technologies to further lessen the impacts of PSPS events to customers. And by the same token, we strongly encourage our customers to develop an emergency backup plan that works and makes sense for their families, for their families or their businesses. Again, there's a real possibility that you may lose power for any multitude of reasons. So while we continue to strengthen and enhance the grid, we would highly encourage you to develop an emergency backup plan that best addresses the specific needs of your family or your business. As always, let's ensure that we have a strong communication bond today as opposed to the day of an emergency event. Please visit us on SCE.com for just a wealth of information around SCE's protocols, wildfire safety, updating contact information, or even just to sign up for a community event or meeting. Also, since I do have a captive audience, I want to deliver a simple commercial. If you have a friend, neighbor, relative, or just anyone you know that may have a heightened medical need for power, then please recommend that they speak with SCE to identify a program that may most benefit them. This may include a free battery backup system or rate support through any of our CARE or FARA programs, or perhaps even a rebate. SAE closely monitors notifications with our critical care customers during PSPS events, so please recommend that they ensure that we have their updated contact information. Now, I know we've said that multiple times today, and I want to continue emphasizing this commercial. Let's ensure that we have your updated contact information at all times, particularly for those customers that have a heightened medical need for power. Finally, and I know I've mentioned this several times, let's ensure that we are able to create an emergency backup plan that makes sense for your family and your business. If you need help getting started on this process, please visit us on se.com to get more information, or even the Red Cross for more details. Well, this really concludes my section of the PSPS. So let me go ahead and turn it over to our Master of Ceremonies for the next section. Eric, back to you.
Thanks, Luis. Thank you, Taylor. It's going here. So in this next section, we're going to talk about preparedness. And as Luis mentioned, developing a plan that's specific for your family and what works for your family or your business is key. You can go to our website, sc.com, and you can download a form that will help you fill out different things or give you ideas of what to plan for. We are, many months away from what we hope, hopefully is a quiet, windy season. But this would be the right time to start planning for, an outage or an emergency when we have blue skies. So, different things to think about, having a go bag or, maybe something in your car, a bag in your car where you have clothes or, a pair of comfortable shoes in case you're separated from home, having bottled water in there, fresh batteries, handheld radio. We use our phones, but as Luis pointed out, during an emergency, it's very easy to deplete your battery resources if you're not prepared. So different things to think about there. If you go to our website, you can download, and here's the path, sce.com, the Outage Center, go to Outage Tips, and then Outage Information Kit. And you can develop your own plan for your family. When we went to a Ventura County Town Hall, we met with a bunch of fire officials, and they had mentioned there's the three P's in case of an emergency. You want to grab your purse, your pets, and your prescriptions. So kind of funny, but an interesting way to think of it. And you can also go to the Red Cross, and they have other tools to kind of help you develop where to go, what to do. A rally point if you're separated from your family members, if you're not all at home. Out of state contact. It was very important. It's interesting where out-of-state numbers, calls going out of state are still working, but the local telecom system is so impacted that local phone calls aren't going through. But if you have that one uncle or aunt, in Washington or another state, you can all know their number and reach out to them, let them know that you're okay. And then as family members check in, they can let you know the status of everyone that's called in. So just an idea to think of there. Also for some of our outages that occurred, unfortunately, some of our maintenance outages are disruptive. They can last 6 to 8, maybe even longer hours each time. For food safety, you want to keep your refrigerators doors closed as much as possible. For those longer outages, you probably want to maybe consider getting a bag of ice and a cooler to hold over your more perishable items, your dairy products, any prescriptions that need to remain refrigerated. Utilizing those coolers and chests, and you can leave a light on as a good indicator of, to make you aware or alert you when your power is restored. And, as Luis mentioned, other tips is, do you know how to open up your garage door if the power goes off? Different things like that. So just different things to keep in mind. Canned goods. We recently went on a trip and we did not have a can opener. So having like a manual can opener would also be a really good tip to keep in mind and have handy. Yeah, that kind of brought us to a standstill. Very short camping trip. So communication resources, what we'll go over. And we've kind of been driving this point home a number of times, myself, Taylor, and Louise, about updating your contact information to ensure that you get timely notifications as they come out. It's a very simple process. Going to sc.com, clicking at the top right. Once you click on that area, you can go into the settings, and you would either need to register or register and put in a new account or create a new account, or just go into your account if you already have this set up. If you go to outage alert preferences, you can input the different types of channels that you want to be communicated with, whether it's email, voice, or text. And I believe you can put in three different email addresses. So, you know, you, your spouse, or, you know, someone else that needs to be aware. Let's say you can put yourself as a contact for maybe an elderly parent or something. So when their power goes off, you get a notification and you can help them prepare and plan. Another resource that we've upgraded recently is our outage map. We've added lots of different tools to it. If you plug in your address on there, you can kind of tell if you're in a high fire risk area, or you can find out what group ID number you're in for potential rotating outages. You know, see where you are on the batting cycle, so to speak, and when that could possibly occur. And you can also put in your, if you're being impacted by an outage, you can identify if you're being impacted by an outage, what the status is, what the estimated restoration times are. So it's a site that we're constantly updating. If your home or your area is in danger of being part of a public safety power shutoff, as Louise had gone over, we will have those areas drawn out of areas that we're concerned about, that we're researching or monitoring. So you'll kind of get an idea, situational awareness of what areas, you know, could be impacted by, you know, high winds. And then finally, we have a number of special tools on different social media sites. We have a very active Twitter page or Twitter channel. We also have a ton of information on YouTube as far as information on how to decipher your bill, as well as safety tips. Instagram, we're always posting pictures of our crews working on poles in different areas. And we're using Nextdoor as a tool to let customers know when there's outages that are going to be occurring. So we've been using that, giving customers a one-day reminder of when an outage is going to occur in their community, so that they, if they happen to miss that physical letter or they didn't see the email, this is hopefully our last chance that we can try to communicate and get the word out to customers. And with that, I believe that is it. I lost track of slides there. There we go. Two phone numbers that I want to leave you with are 800-655-4555 number. This is our general number to call into one of our call center representatives. They can assist you with your bill. If you happen to be moving or turning off service, they can help you there. You can also go to the website for a lot of those transactions. But if you're experiencing a power outage, if you're having issues with, you know, a tree in your lines, if you notice, you know, something that isn't safe, you can call the second number, 1-800-611-1911. This number is for emergent outage-related issues. You'll be routed or prioritized in the list, in the line of customers, and you'll get to an energy advisor first, and they'll get your information, and we'll send a troubleman or a field representative out there to investigate what the problem is, if it's a power outage or if it's a wire down, what have you. And with that, we are at the end of our presentation. I want to see if we have any questions, or does anyone have any questions that they want to type in?
Eric, at this time, there's no questions posted in the chat, but if we want to give it a few minutes, a couple minutes. Okay.
Thank you, Monet. And just a reminder for those that joined late, we'll send out a presentation email to everybody. If you want to get a copy of the presentation, along with all the links to the different various resources that we've shared, I know Monet's dropped a lot of pages on the chat that you can view and go to. If you fill out a brief survey for our presentation on how we did, where we can improve, we'll send you a copy of the presentation. All right, I guess I don't see anyone typing. How much distance should be between the top of the tree and the power lines? So I believe Luis mentioned that we usually trim back a 12-foot clearance, but if there's any question, if there's any doubt, you can call the 800-611-1911 number, and we'll send someone out there to take a look and verify if it's a safe condition or not. But typically we trim back about 12 feet. Thank you. Thank you for the question. Right. Well, we will send out an email. If you have any final questions, you can always respond to that email and follow up with us. If it's something that we can answer, we'll definitely give it our best shot. We'll give you an answer. Or if it's something that's outside our swing zone, we'll route you to someone within Edison that can follow up with you. I do want to thank you all for participating and showing your interest in our Power Talk. Thank you to our speakers and Monet on the sidelines, helping us monitor and drop links to everybody. Thank you all. And I hope you guys have a nice rest of your afternoon. Thank you.